Okay, everyone. So we're going to talk about research directions in augmentation. I'm going to keep it very broad, and this is the overview. So we're going to talk about this idea of, who's heard of XR? So XR is a new term that incorporates augmented reality. We'll talk about that. We're going to talk about this idea of programming reality as a medium. We're going to talk about empathic computing, exercising your peripheral vision, pedagogies for augmented reality and mixed reality, the idea that virtual reality is becoming mixed reality. We're going to talk about AR mapping and the AR cloud, mirror worlds. And we're going to talk about intermediality, volumetric display, which is how you a way of making content for mixed reality. We're going to talk about digital assistants. We're going to talk about some dream hacking, some programmable synthetic experiences. We're going to talk about the debate between hyperhumanism and transhumanism. And we're going to talk about some XR augmentation methodologies. Then we're going to finish with some projects that incorporate a lot of these areas, finishing off with some challenges and conclusions. So this idea of XR stands for cross or extended reality. It's an umbrella term to simplify the understanding and adoption of the full range of immersive technologies that generate new forms of reality. We've already talked about these different realities and how we can cut across them, how we can build things across these different realities for cognition, for learning. So this new term is meant to simplify things, but it's a bit rich when it's still needing to be explained. But it's something that we're trying to push at the OR conference in Munich recently. This was the general buzzword. The XR is the new umbrella term for all of these things. It also includes things like sensors, cinema, all sorts of different areas that relate to immersive technologies. So this explosion of hybrid and perceptual technology can lead to new cognitive and creative insights. But you arguably can't get there just with augmented reality. This is why I'm talking to you about all these different things in terms of immersive tech. So this allows us to explore sensory augmentation, artificial senses, combining senses, creating entirely new ones, body hacking, all sorts of different areas, which I think is interesting and relevant for your project ideas. So think about it like cooking. Think about a lot of these different technologies as ingredients that you can incorporate, and you can create a stack of these technologies, and how they interact is a protocol. So think about how you create these protocols. So we're still lacking frameworks and methodologies for these because they're so new. So reality, as we're seeing, is becoming programmable. And if reality is programmable, then reality becomes a medium. So what are the dangers and what are the benefits of this idea? This idea, which I've talked about recently, is this idea of context engineering. How do we create not new content, but how do we create context? How do we change the way we perceive reality and make that the content? So there's loads of different tools now that allow us to make context. And this is a new economy. If you think about, a lot of people want to have rich experiences. They don't want to consume so much, you know, like they used to. They want to actually experience a change in their perception. And this is the new way of the world. So it's summarized with this term, reimagining what already exists and using perspective to shape reality instead of changing reality itself. So that's context engineering. And you can see an example here with this Chinese artist that's actually using not actually any technology. She's just using these convex and concave mirrors to change the way she looks, because that's, you know, this is the idea that you're changing your reality. So this is obviously potentially very interesting, but also quite scary, because our perceptions already, without any of this stuff, are gambles. This is a quote from Robert Anton Wilson. We believe what we see, and then we believe our interpretation of it. We don't even know we are making an interpretation most of the time. We think this is objective reality, whereas it's always some sort of process that you're going through to create that reality. So we we're losing common ground. And this is, I'm talking about the dangers of this stuff. We're losing common ground. You know, we're all entering different reality tunnels with the media that we choose. You know, we're looking at different television programs. There's so much choice. Whereas before there used to be four channels on TV, we could talk about this sort of objective world, but that's fast disappearing, especially when we're all plugging into different technologies, different levels of those realities. Reality is scary enough without having the infinite ability. And remember, I talked about N realities, the infinite ability to change the way you're perceiving it. And then you can also, you know, you think about people with synesthesia, you know, they're already mixing up their senses, but this sort of technology allows you to do that. So Billinghurst talks about this idea of empathic computing, and he talks about it in three levels. So you need understanding, systems that can understand your feelings and emotions. Second level, experiencing, systems that help you better experience the world of others, systems that help you better share these experiences. So if you think about the first level as being something in VR, this is sort of an idea of combining these technologies. Experiencing is the senses. So we can experience others through senses. And sharing, this is what augmented reality is good at. We can share the experience of others. We can wear somebody else. We can look through their eyes. And I'll give you an example of that.
Childhood project that transformed transform your embodiment into a child by using wearable devices. Here we have the hand exoskeleton to simulate child's tiny hand, and we also have a viewpoint translator to simulate child's perspective. So this is the hand exoskeleton. It's based on the 5 years old children's dimensions, so designers can feel the usability of products and toys for the children through their own hand.
This is the adult's normal stature and normal IPD, the papillary distance. And children has a little smaller, closer papillary distance, so I make it a little closer. And I make my stature lower by removing my eyes like this and put it here. This is about 1 meter stature. The children who is 5 years old. This is the viewpoint.
So Billinghurst actually at OR in 2016 was talking about how powerful this experience was to basically go back into the body and to use multiple senses, multiple modalities. So it really tricks you. Your brain's going, you know, your brain is just a black box. It accepts inputs and then, you know, it tries to work out what's happening. So I'm really interested in, you know, what we've basically grown up with, or certainly what I've grown up with is this constant use of, you know, screens and very, very unhealthy technologies. And I think as Fridolin says, this mixed reality, augmented reality is the next level of personal computing, which is arguably much more healthy or has the potential to be much more healthy because it returns you to the body, natural interaction. You know, we've talked a lot about this with gesture, you know, interacting with the machine so it becomes invisible. And also, if you think about things like peripheral vision, we've massively been starved of peripheral vision because we're staring at these tiny screens. You know, and if you think about how important peripheral vision is to learning, to memory, you know, these things are fundamental for the way we design our technologies. And you can do an exercise now very quickly to understand this idea about peripheral vision. So this is an exercise I do before a talk, and lots of athletes do it before big races. And all you do is you stare in front of you, and instead of just staring straight ahead like you normally do, just defocus and actually stare into the entire 180-degree field of view, and you'll notice within a few seconds that your whole physiology starts to calm down. Now, obviously, we spend most of our time staring at small screens, at phones, but if you think about mixed reality, virtual reality, it encompasses the 360 degrees again, so we're going back into a place where we're exercising our peripheral vision and therefore human factors, ergonomics, it improves that. So I'm really interested in how do we create, you know, pedagogies for using these technologies. And my early work was actually looking at doing a lot of 3D modeling. This is something that I built nearly 20 years ago now in CAD and then in 3D Max. And what was really interesting about it is that it became obvious to me, having done 7 years of 3D modeling, that my brain had changed, that suddenly I was looking at something like this, where this is a memory palace. So memory palaces are really interesting because the Greek orators, they didn't write anything down. They had these 7-hour speeches and they memorized them with virtual architecture that they would create in their heads. So you think about this sort of structure, and they would map different parts of their speech to different architectural features and then just walk through it to trigger the whole speech. So they could memorize such amazing amounts of information. And if you think about augmented reality, we're back in the world again. We're tagging information into space, just like the Greek orators were doing 2,000 years ago. And as Malevich says, the best way to approach the design of mixed reality or augmented space is to consider it as an architectural or spatial literacy problem, because the application of meaning on space is a native concern. And you're seeing this with redesigns of these memory palaces in interface design. So moving on to the next section, this is looking at the question of virtual reality becoming mixed reality. And this was the experience that I told you about at the Saatchi Gallery called We Live in Oceans of Air. And actually, that's me touching my girlfriend's hand. And I'm only able to do that because I'm able to see her in the space. And this is still pure VR, but it's still getting you into the idea, because what you're seeing in this simulated world is you're seeing people walking around as bodies of blood. So you can actually, because you're wearing sensors, you can actually see the blood flowing through these people, and they're all walking around. And I just knew the height of her, so I could tell that was her. But this is Varjo. This is an interesting bit of kit.
Since we can't change reality, we change the eyes that see reality.
What you're seeing there is basically the mixing again of the virtual and the real, but in a VR, what was traditionally a VR headset. This is another example of the kind of things you can do. I don't know if I've mentioned pass-through camera, but with a lot of VR headsets, you can turn on the camera. If you've got a mobile phone in the solution, you can turn on the camera. It's called pass-through camera, and that turns again your VR headset into AR, or you can actually see the world. Doesn't turn it into AR, but it allows you to at least see what's in the world. So have a look at this example. So these are the kinds of tricks that you can do when you have that solution. So this is what's called diminished reality, is taking things away from reality. Another thing I've seen recently while preparing for this talk was this idea of intermediality, which is where you're combining different forms of media. So one output of one media becomes the input to another. And you can see here where they're combining augmented reality with 3D printing. So you're literally grabbing your whatever it is you want to print into AR, and then you're placing it in a 3D printer. And then you can see at the end of result there, you're actually able to see your 3D print. Another example of this idea of intermediality is this Kenyan engineer who's created gloves that can turn sign language into audible speech. So a real breakthrough for the whole community. And this is the Google Maps AR solution, because we all know that problem of getting lost on your 2D screen.
Completely walking in the wrong direction until the little blue dot finally catches up. The Google Maps team is working on a way to make that part of travel a lot easier, especially for pedestrians. It's working on a feature that can superimpose your navigation on top of a live view of the real world. Forget the map, you just see the street and there's a big bunch of arrows saying, go that way. Google lent us a phone with a new version of Maps on it so we could test out the feature. So let's go for a walk.
So we don't need to go for the walk, but you see the point. Get rid of the map and just use the real world, augment the real world. So it's just, again, such a simple idea, but... And this is actually for pilots, augmented reality view for pilots, where they can actually see their entire view overlaid on top of the real view. So then you get, you know, you get rid of the map. You can just see the overlay of where countries are.
Torrance Tower, Richard 366 Charlie Alpha, inbound on the ILS.
366 Charlie Alpha, Torrance Tower, continue to Nunnery.
So this other idea, AR, this was something that was launched again in Munich at the Augmented World Expo. AR Cloud is the very fundamental need to have a way of mapping your digital content anywhere in the world. So it needs to be a joint effort. So what's so interesting about augmented reality and mixed reality is that it takes so many different people to work on it collaboratively for it to work. Another example.
The frames that you see is not rendered by a graphics engine. It's actually rendered by AI technology that we built.
This is the first time we combine machine learning and computer graphics to do image generation using deep networks.
For training data, we are given some driving sequences of different cities. And then we use another segmentation network to extract the high-level semantics from these sequences. We have the UE4 engine to generate these colorized high-level layouts. Different objects were given different colors.
The network converts this representation to images.
I met my co-author to dance Gangnam Style, which I don't think he would do by himself.
We find some good dancing videos from another person and then use my model to synthesize the dance move. That was created by machines, it's not me.
So along those lines, we're very interested in volumetric display, both myself and Fridolin. We've had a holoportal at my institution at Ravensbourne in London. So similar to what you're doing here with the scanner, but that scans you in a still form. This captures you moving. So we've had this for a couple of years, and it's very interesting all the different applications we've had and different opportunities we've had as a result of having this. And basically what it means is that, again, you can do context engineering because you can take your context, you can take the content that you've created, the scan, and you can put it into multiple different contexts. So you can put it into games, you can put it into films, you can put it into AR. And that's what we did with it very early on, was actually think, oh, hang on a minute, this could be a great way of creating content for mixed reality. The first project we ever did a couple of years ago was create a mixed reality fashion show, the very first mixed reality fashion show, where you turn up to a catwalk and all you've got are the HoloLenses. There's no models there because we've scanned them all in the HoloPortal and then they're walking up and down in front of you, but only you can see them because you've got the headset on. So it's an interesting area. What we've realized what we're doing is kind of creating an Airbnb of bodies. And I joke with some of my colleagues at work that, you know, instead of spending a lot of money and a lot of time flying to a location, you could actually send some sort of hologram of you giving the lecture. So at least you're in a site-specific situation. But, you know, a lot of the students are already saying, not sure if I want a copy of myself to be out there in the world for obvious reasons. You know, ethically, data protection, there's lots of issues around this stuff. But one thing that was interesting was this project where students were designing products, actual physical products, out of waste material, and they wanted to take those products on a tour around Europe. And I was like, don't send the products, send the holograms of the products, and then you save even more waste. So this is the kind of stuff that we're able to generate. So these footballers have been scanned in the holoportal, and then obviously with the HoloLens, you can place them anywhere you want. Like was previously said, you become the director and the cameraman just by having this content to move around.
I need a bit of advice. Who can I beam into the operating theatre? I know, I'll call my colleague Shafi.
Hi, Carl.
Hi, Shafi.
How can I help you? You called me.
Great, we've got a bit of an issue in the operating theatre. Can you offer some advice?
Of course. Let's see what we can do for you, Carl. Thanks for calling me in.
So Shafi's actually in the holoportal, which is next door, you can see there. And we're filming him and then able to shrink him down. This was when the algorithms were pretty weak. And basically we're viewing him in the HoloLens and then obviously capturing that view. This is another example. So just before I go into that, so imagine 3D Skype. You know, a lot of the problems that we have at the moment when we want to see somebody is because we don't want to just see them on a flat screen. We want to, but imagine a scenario and it's already, you know, becoming possible where we could sit around a table and look through our holographic eyes and hear through our holographic ears and actually be there, you know, as much as we are now. So again, I'm really interested in how do we use technologies for good? And, you know, avoiding flying everywhere would be a very good thing. So this is completely computer generated. So again, what are the application areas for having these digital assistants? You know, what kind of things could you do with them? And, you know, that's another huge application area. Another example.
It's totally fake news. It's just fake.
I actually created one AR. I created it for myself. It's a very strange feeling. So it's personal to you, but it's still a sort of a different person. Maybe you can frame it as a very extremely good friend for yourself who knows you inside and out.
So yeah, I mean, think about all of the data. I mean, the common line is that Facebook knows you better than your mum does. And I think that's true. So if you can get that data set and then feed it into an AI, create a version of yourself that, you know, you might want to ask questions. And, you know, from my perspective, I've written a diary for 20 years, and that is a majorly interesting data set because I've only got the most, you know, just the summaries. I don't have all the noise. I just have the summaries of all the important things that happen. And I write it from three levels. I write what I did, which is the content. I write what I felt, which is the context, and then I also write what I thought, key ideas that I might have had, and that's the concepts. So those three levels, feeding all of that data into an AI, could it give me answers to questions that I can't answer myself? So moving on to this idea of dream hacking, how many of you have lucid dreams? Yeah, hardly anyone. But they're finding ways now to actually use very small amounts of transcranial stimulation. This is the passenger helmet, which was developed in the 60s. You wouldn't wear this in bed, but they've got much more up-to-date versions. And they found that a small amount of electricity placed in the right part of the brain or the right part of the head, so you'd wear it like a cap. When you go into REM sleep, then basically it creates lucid dreams reliably. So therefore we could actually, and the idea of a lucid dream state is that you can wake up in your dream and actually do all sorts of things that you couldn't do in reality. A lot of people use lucid dreams for training. So they might do Tai Chi in a dream. And the argument for doing it is that you're able to, it's four times more effective to train in a lucid dream than it is in a waking state. So, you know, again, going back to the Greek orators creating these virtual memory palaces, lucid dreaming is a real skill because you have to apply gravity. You have to do all these things that are normally obvious, but you have to do that yourselves. They've also found that you can, when you're learning new vocabularies in your dream, it's, again, a much easier process. So this is a more out there one from MIT. Programmable Synthetic Hallucinations describes the utilization of the biophysical mechanics of hallucination generated in the human brain to display virtual information directly in the visual field. By again using transcranial, you can stimulate the cells in the hypercolumns of V1, which can induce the perception of a pixel of light within the visual field of the user. So, you know, it's quite mad, but this is a true mixed reality where we're able to actually create visual effects through electricity. There's lots of research going into this idea of how do we, Olaf Blanke and Karolinska Institute in Sweden, they're doing all these experiments where they can put you into like a Barbie doll, like perceptually, you can actually go into a Barbie doll. You can be sitting 10 foot away from yourself. And again, just wearing a VR headset, looking, if you're sitting in a VR, sitting in a chair and then the camera's 10 feet behind you, then you're basically, and your view is in the camera behind you, then you think you're sitting 10 foot away from yourself and you have an instant out of body experience. So again, just a very easy thing to trick the brain. But these are other ways of doing that. But it's, you know, it's super interesting if our consciousness becomes so malleable that we're able to do, you know, put this into the stack, into the protocol. And this is also work done with stimulating the brain directly with, again, transcranial stimulation. This is, again, more research, recent research. MIT able to basically pinpoint, sounds to go directly into your ears. This idea that, you know, people are already walking around looking like they're insane because they're talking to themselves and you don't know where they're talking or whether they are actually talking to themselves. This is what's coming, this sort of reality tunnel. This is Cyborg Nest, who I told you about with the North Sense. So Cyborg Nest, this is Moon Rebus, and she's got a prosthetic device that shakes every time there's an earthquake in the world. So she's got this, and depending on the size of the earthquake, the more her arm shakes. So she does these performances for an hour, and if there's no earthquake in the world, she doesn't do anything. So she's got a direct relationship with the world that no one else does. So it's kind of like she can feel the heartbeat of planet Earth. So that's what I want you to think about. Think about all these different ways these technologies can do interesting things and allow you to have interesting knowledge that no one else has. And this is some more wacky research where you can turn anything into a robot. So your cuddly toys at home with the addition of this robotic skin is again another way of augmenting the reality. So let me give you another little video.
We are really acquiring divine abilities of creation and destruction. For the first time, we are going to have the ability to re-engineer life, to re-engineer bodies and brains and minds. And we have no idea what to do with these powers. If we just leave it to the free market, or if we just leave it to an arms race, it guarantees the worst outcome.
Which is why we need those global institutions that are currently being pulled apart.
Yeah, I mean, if you just, you know, if you have an arms race in these technologies, then it's very clear what kind of human abilities are going to be optimized. It will be things like intelligence, things like discipline. Armies and corporations and governments, they want highly intelligent and highly disciplined soldiers and workers and citizens. But other things like compassion, like autistic appreciation, like spirituality, these are things that are not on a very high on the list of armies and corporations. So the attempt to upgrade humans might actually result in downgraded humans, like what we do to the animals. If you compare a domesticated cow to a wild cow, so a domesticated cow produces more milk and is far more obedient, but in almost every other respect, it's a downgrade from the wild cows. And we are on the verge of maybe doing the same thing to human beings.
So I'm trying to give you all the different sides of the story, so you can make up your own minds what you should be doing with technologies. But there's there's an interesting debate around this transhumanism. I'm really not a fan of it. I'm much more interested in this hyperhumanism idea. And to give you an example of that, you've got at the top there the field space belt. And the north, this is the chip that I was telling you that every time you face north, it vibrates. So this is the North Sense app application from Cyborg Nest. But the difference between the two is that the field space belt is something that you wear for, say, 3 or 4 weeks. It's got magnets in it. Every time you face north, you get this new skill. You know where north is. But you take it off, and then you have that new sense. Whereas, you know, the tagline from Cyborg Nest is that we don't want to wear technology, we want to become it, which is a very transhumanist way of looking at it. So hyperhumanism is the idea that you use a technology to give you a new skill or a new muscle, but then you take it off. It's like the stabilizers on your bike. You don't keep them on. You use them just for a temporary amount of time until you've got a new skill. Think about all the things that, one second, think about all the things with spell checkers, you know, location, you know, GPS has destroyed our sense of location. So again, it's a very bad use of technology. Technologies, prosthetic devices that give you a new skill, but then you have that as a new skill. You don't depend on the technology. You don't become technology. Another little video which goes into this a lot more.
I think we still know so little about what it means to be human that the confidence with which we think we can upload ourselves to silicon or recreate ourselves with algorithms is shocking to me. The only ones out there who think they know what human consciousness is are computer engineers. If you talk to actual brain researchers and neuroscientists, they say we're nowhere close. We don't know where we come from. We don't even know if there's a meaning to this universe or not. Yet we think that we can make a simulation that's as valid as this. Every simulation we make misses something. Think about the difference between being in a jazz club and listening to a great CD. There's a difference, you know, and some of those differences we understand and some of them we don't. So when I see people rushing off to upload consciousness to a chip, it feels more like escape from humanity than it is a journey forward. And I get it. Life is scary. I mean, women, real life women are scary. You know, the people are scary. The moisture is scary. Death is scary. Babies are scary. Other people who don't speak the same language or have the same customs, they're scary. All sorts of stuff is scary. And I understand the idea of this kind of a having a SimCity perfected simulation that I can go into and not have to worry about all that stuff I don't know, where everything is discrete, everything is a yes, no, this, that, all the choices have been made. There's a certain attractiveness to that, but that's dead. It's not alive. There's no wonder. There's no awe. There's nothing strange and liminal and ambiguous about it. I was on a panel with a famous transhumanist, and he was arguing that it's time that human beings come to accept that we will have to pass the torch of evolution to our digital successors, and that once computers have the singularity and they're really thinking and better than us, then we should really only stick around as long as the computers need us, you know, to keep the lights on.
So basically he's talking about Ray Kurzweil. Ray Kurzweil is the sort of the big transhumanist. I'm also going to be on a panel with Ray Kurzweil in Melbourne next month, and I'm going to talk a lot about this, these problems, and ask him why he thinks that, you know, we should just give up our humanity. And Team Human, if you look up Team Human, this is what came out of, you know, a sort of an anti-transhumanist approach.
Moving on to the challenges and implications. Google actually patented this gesture because it triggered an action on the Google Glass device. So actually, Google now owns that gesture, at least in America. In Europe, they wouldn't allow such a thing. And we don't know the implications of the technologies that we're producing until they're beta tested, until they're out in the world. An example of some of the unknown implications of these devices and technologies is the Tetris video game. Apparently, it cures the lazy eye problem. We can now radically adopt different visual auditory systems. You can spend time out of body in the third person or focused in peripheral vision. We can also body swap and gender swap from to be another lab. And this pursuit of new states of perception and forms of experience is leading to cognitive and creative insights. One of the fundamental problems remains that we are very technocentric and we tend to think of a solution before we actually define a human need. And also our perceptual range and resulting behavior is increasingly predetermined by the technologies, techniques, and devices. And those things are being produced by corporations. So, you know, what's their end game and what's their goal with these devices and the resulting behavior that they're likely to induce? And I'm very interested in how can we create frameworks of use around these augmentation techniques and methodologies. It's a bit like the Wild West out there, and I hope this lecture's shown you some of the range of different augmentation technologies and the methodologies as well. So thank you very much for listening, and I hope you've enjoyed this lecture.